right, and welcome everyone to Three Ways to Knock Out Competitor, Supplier, Vendor Relationships. I'm excited to be here because we have a ton of information condensed into 30 minutes. My job is to make this very practical, applicable. But your job is to take some of these concepts and mold them, make them meaningful and specific to your unique challenges and opportunities that you're dealing with out in the field. There are three things that I'm going to cover today, but before we do that, let me ask if these are your challenges. Are you dealing with an individual who is happy or complacent, satisfied, been using the same vendor relationship for the last 5, 10, 15, 20 plus years? And it seems and the fact is you're really trying to get this individual, these potential relationships to be a little bit more receptive to change, new ideas, and obviously your solution. Do you struggle with this? I got an email in preparation for a client I'm working with right now, and they're saying our challenge is we are a me too vendor. And when you're in that position of a me too, guess what happens? Are you struggling on selling on price? Even when you capitulate, lower your price, or you really want to entice this opportunity, because if you can drive that price down, they'll give you an opportunity. They'll give you a chance, hopefully, that you'll get the business. But guess what? They never, never step up to the plate. Is that a challenge you're facing? Or do you ever feel like, you know, you really want to gain the respect, the trust, the credibility, the rapport, that they do really see you as a partner, not as somebody that they're just throwing a bone out to you, or once in a while, just to keep you in the loop, they'll give you a little bit of pieces here and there. But the reality is they don't give you your fair share of the business. Well, if these are your challenges, this is what we want to cover today. I'm going to start with number one that you want to be thinking about is pretty straightforward, but I see too many times salespeople getting bogged down calling on the wrong person. And the challenge is when we're not getting in front of the right people. In other words, if you're really creating and selling value, you're the highest priced premium solution out in the marketplace because you really do impact the bottom line, and yet you're calling on somebody in the purchasing buying role who's really focused and thinking about price, there's a conflict there. There's a problem. How many of us have been calling on individuals, certain points of contact, they're easy to get a hold of, but we're being told everything's good, we're satisfied, we're happy with our current situation. We've been using the same vendor. You know, I saw this situation take place in a manufacturing environment, and I suggested to the salesperson, let's get in there. Let's start digging a little bit deeper, broader, and higher. Let's talk to the people who push the brooms, right, who handle the mops. Yeah, that's right, the people who are getting down and dirty, getting 10 bucks an hour. Let's find out what's really going on. And it's interesting. All of a sudden, we start talking to other people. We started talking to the food handlers. We talked about the people who are processing the equipment. All of a sudden, we're finding out that equipment is breaking down. There's downtime issues. We also found out there was food contamination, meaning some serious issues. They had to literally shut down the line for 48 hours. What we were finding out as we're talking to the individuals is that, whoa, all this packages of food aren't getting fulfilled, at least 5,000 bags of food per hour. Guess what? $10,000 an hour, $240,000 a day, $480,000 over a two-day period. How long has this been going on? Once a month. All of a sudden, we're finding out some real clues here. And then we talk to the plant manager, and we find out the biggest customer worth $5 million is threatening to pull the plug because we're finding out that they're unhappy with the quality. What's my recommendation here? When you're hitting a brick wall, what should we do? Be an investigative sleuth and start learning elsewhere what else is going on in the organization. Number two I want you to be thinking about is, are you asking the right questions? Think about this now. How many times are we going into situations where we're trying to find out, okay, who are you using right now? Okay, who is this supplier? What's the name? What do you like about them now? What don't you like? If there was one thing that you would change about this vendor relationship, what might it be? Can I have an opportunity to quote? can I have a chance to maybe just get demonstrate what we can do for you? You know what? I hear you going in like that, but let me share with you something, a challenge that you may be facing with that approach. You could be perceived as groveling, begging, or annoying this opportunity. My recommendation is, as much as you want to get in there to understand what's going on with the existing vendor relationship, the paradigm is you could be shutting down the conversation. As much as we think that they're passionate, they're in love with their current vendor relationship, I really question the validity of that. Where I want you to be thinking about is, hold off on those questions that I just posed to you, and I want you to go elsewhere. Here are key areas to really disrupt existing vendor relationships. Number one, I want you to be thinking about, when you're asking the right questions, explore what's going on in their organization. My question to you is this. If I were to poll everybody attending today's session, and I were to ask you this question, are you experiencing any change in your company? 93% of the hands would go up and say yes. And if I were to follow up and say, are you experiencing a little change or a lot of change? 90% of people would say a lot of change. Now, is it fair to say that the prospects that you're calling on, that they would respond in the same or similar way about their own businesses? And the reality is, yes, they would. Now, I tell you this because this was the approach that I worked with a salesperson in the IT industry. And his challenge, too, was disrupting an existing vendor relationship. We're on a first-time call, calling on the director of IT. We're getting involved in some icebreakers, talking about some things, what's going on, just some basic stuff 5 minutes into the conversation. And then what the salesperson did was then to focus in on with the question. So tell me a little bit about some of the changes that you and your company are experiencing when it comes to managing your IT systems. Interesting enough, because the prospect perked up, got animated and said, changes? Are you kidding me? We're experiencing a lot of changes. As I look back 5 years ago when I started with this company, it was just some basic stuff about sharing and having access to the data. Today, it's all about protecting the data against cyber threats and attacks. And as we're looking at 3 to 5 years from now, we got a big shift. It's all about allowing our customers to access our data through mobile apps and make it easier for them. And at the same time, not putting ourselves at risk. The prospect, because we hit a nerve, continues talking about, he was saying, my focus in IT now is shifting away from being internally driven, and now I'm thrusted into a customer service, customer experience role, where I really need to understand what the customer wants. And it's taken me out of my comfort zone. And you know, as the prospect's talking, 4 minutes into the conversation, says, you know, it's interesting. I got a question for you. Tell me, do you do much when it comes to mobile apps? And the reason I say that is because we're shifting in that direction and our current vendor has little experience. Where am I going with this? When you get customers and prospects talking about change, then they start thinking about what? Thinking about the pain, the frustrations, the anxieties, the challenges that they're experiencing. Because as one of my clients, electrical distributor, said it so well, he said, where there's pain, there's a PO. My job, our job today is find out who has the pain. Because when we can emotionally connect with a prospect, then they become more receptive and open to change and new ideas and opportunities, willing to listen and embrace our ideas, but only if we can get to the business pain, the frustrations, the problems. So what's your takeaway so far? Here's what I'll ask you to jot down. Be jotting down these questions. Tell me what changes that you're experiencing on the job, or what are some of the changes you're experiencing with this project? What's going on with the team, the department? What do you see going on with changes in the marketplace with your customers? Now, when it comes to the follow-up, though, is you want to unearth the pain. And that's as simple as asking the question, how's that affecting you? Or help me to understand the problems you're encountering with this. So you told me that the goals in the next 3 to 5 years is to achieve. Obviously, there's going to be hurdles, problems, challenges, and get in the way. What are they? And as people talk about those issues, what you're doing is it enables you to position, that's right, position your solution as the opportunity to resolve those issues. Bring the pain up, then present the solution. Don't dump your solution on people when they're not receptive or open. Why? Because they're not listening. So here we have it. I want you to also be thinking about this, and that is understanding the relationships that are involved. Now, I tell you this because too many times when we're calling, trying to find out who is the decision maker, what we need to find out is, here's what's going on. When you're calling on people and saying that we're satisfied, we're content, everything's fine, you know what? We're hitting the wrong sparks. Now, what's going on is because, for the most part, most people are afraid of the unknown, the risk of looking stupid, taking a chance, where, you know what, it could be blemish on them when they take a risk on a new opportunity, meaning you. So complacency sets in, status quo. And you know what the number one frustration is with CEOs, owners, and presidents of organizations is getting their people to be more motivated and embrace change. All you want to do is turn this around. Turn it around from the fear of the unknown to the desire for success. Now, let me give you an example. A salesperson is selling laboratory product supplies to this purchasing agent and not getting a lot of inroads because trying to understand what they value, and it came down to it was about price. Well, besides price, what else do you value? Price, all right? Hitting some roadblocks, but as he was continued, he was also able to find out some delivery issues, some quality issues, some integrity, service. What he was able to find out by really asking the right questions is that what was important to her from a purchasing role is, I don't want headaches, I don't want people yelling, screaming, complaining, or whining because the products aren't there, things are breaking down, we're not getting the service support that we need. Wanting to look good, to be recognized as a team player, to advance one's career, to meet that performance scorecard, right? We need to understand what people value. It's as simple as that. Here's where I'm going to ask you to go, because when you understand what people value and that I want to disrupt this existing vendor relationship, I need to understand the points of contact, the people involved, and what they value. And all it comes down to is the question, the simple question is, you know what, help me understand from your perspective, what exactly is it that you value most when it comes to X, Y, or Z? Tell me, because other people are involved in this decision-making process, tell me what's important to your cohorts. What do they see as value? Help me understand, because of the project, this application, this opportunity, how does the team, how does the department, how's your boss define value? All right. I say this because in working with one key distributor, one of the challenges was going after, they were looking at a very competitive environment. They had multiple bid situations, opportunities coming up. It was a $5 million opportunity. They had two key objectives. And the objectives, number one, was to understand the decision-making process. And then number two was to understand what they value. They asked that question, walk me through your decision-making process. What they found out was there was project coordinators involved, then the purchasing team. From there, then it went to the contractors. And from there, after the contractors signed off, then they found out the engineers gave their input. And then it was submitted to be finalized by the architects and then the end user. And as they found out all the parties that were involved in this project, then they said, okay, let's talk about what's important to you from a project coordinator. What is it that you specifically value? And then it was all about apple-to-apple comparisons. From then they went to the purchasing, they found out it was all about price. When they went to the contractors, they found out from a value standpoint, labor and time savings. Engineers, the value was the quality. It was all about the quality and performance. The architects, it was all about integrity, peace of mind, litigation risks. End user, it was about getting the project all finished, completed, on time, being delivered to the customer. And you know what happened? Closed a $5 million opportunity by focusing on that and disrupting the existing vendor relationship in place. So what I want you to be thinking about is, as you explore these opportunities, what they value, recognize that when you're trying to disrupt an existing vendor relationship and you're trying to sell on price, to entice on price, that's a big risk. Because as much as people try to push you and prompt you to lower you on price, what they care about is they're not in the business to save money. They're in the business to make money, to improve margins, to grow more revenue, to gain market share, to reinforce the value that they're giving to their end users. So if you're going to disrupt these established relationships, what you want to be looking at is understanding what's going to motivate these customers. And I'll challenge you, because what I want you to be thinking about is the only way you can present a viable, meaningful impact solution if you know what those hot buttons are, right? What's going to motivate them to take action? So, and recognize that companies don't, when people tell you, well, we got to submit this to the board, to the committee, we got to get others to sign off on it, as much as we hear that and we get pushed off, what happens is companies don't make decisions. We're led to believe that. People do. My job and your job is to find out who's that champion. Who's that person who's living and breathing with that problem, that anxiety, that challenge, that frustration, that can become that champion who really sees a vested interest wanting me to win, because not only am I going to make them look good and be a hero, but it's going to make an impact on the bottom line. Why? Because when emotions and logic cross, which one rules? Emotions do. Let me give you a quick example why this is so important. Because a salesperson I was working with over a year ago was selling radiography equipment, calling on a hospital, calling on the CEO, and literally 10 seconds into the conversation, the CEO says, why do I want to buy from you? Because, you know, I look at our existing vendor relationship, what we're doing now, we're content, we're happy. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to be upfront with you. You're $10,000 more than who we're using now, and your technology is behind the times. It's too basic. My question to you is, how do you even respond to that? And the salesperson just handled that beautifully. What did she say? She came back and said, you know, doctor, I can appreciate that when you talk about this, these issues, because let me ask you, price should be a concern. But when it comes to value, what exactly do you look for? And so the doctor CEO responded, well, I'll tell you what I look for. It's about profitability. We got to be profitable because being a hospital, it's lean and mean. Our margins are so slim. We also need to be concerned about ease of use. Ease of use is everything to us because that protects our margins, minimizes litigation, because people can sometimes be resistant to change, keeping the cost down, right? So the salesperson said, let's talk about that. When you talk about profitability, let me ask you, with the existing equipment that you're using now, how many patients can you operate using that piece of equipment? And the doctor CEO said, about 8 patients a day. So reimbursement, what does that mean? $2,000, right, per patient. Well, look at our piece of equipment. We're talking about 10 patients a day. What would that mean to you from a bottom-line standpoint over a course of a month, a week, or a year? So the doctor CEO started tabulating, well, $2,000, $4,000 a day, that would be $20,000 a week. That would be $80,000. Okay, $80,000 a month. Okay. Almost $1 million. Continued and said, let me ask you. The salesperson said, what about the ease of use? With the more advanced technology you're currently using now, it requires 2 clinicians versus 1 using our piece of equipment. What does it cost you to hire, train, and retain an existing clinician to use that current piece of equipment? And the doctor CEO said, probably $200,000. Conversation, 45-minute conversation. What do you think that salesperson walked away with? Higher price solution, technology backwards, and walked away with a PO for almost $50,000. Why? Because we're appealing to what motivates people. And that is, can I demonstrate a return on investment? Can I appeal to what motivates people? In other words, becoming more profitable, being more successful, eliminating some of the headaches, the frustrations, the anxieties, the doubts, the concerns that I have. Why? Because they see me as a viable solution that's going to have an impact on their success personally and professionally, and the organization is going to gain that competitive edge. Those are the things that we want to lay as the foundation to build upon. Why? So we can disrupt these existing vendor relationships. So let me summarize these three things. Number one, are you getting in front of the right people? Are you being inquisitive to find out when you're getting pushed, when you're getting blocked, when you're getting tackled, when you're not hearing the message, you know something's not right to say, wait a minute, this person's in a complacent mindset, and yet their whole marketplace, their whole world, their whole organization is experiencing so much volatility, change, and frustration and pressures. Who do I need to talk to? Dig deep, broad, and high. For anybody who needs to upsell, cross-sell, and expand those opportunities because you're selling a plethora of solutions, products, and services, that's your opportunity. And then you need to look at ways to ask the right questions. Don't focus, as much as I'd like to tell you about vendor relationships, probably 8 out of 10 prospective opportunities that you call on, when they're saying they're satisfied with their existing vendor relationship, you didn't hit a nerve. Because the reality is very few are passionate, motivated, excited, or truly value that vendor relationship where they see them truly as a partner, where they're inviting them to the executive table. And probably not. Where you can exploit it is because these prospective customers, too often with those vendor relationships, they too are falling in a state of complacency. They're no longer proactively, strategically engaging their customers, but going there as a customer service approach, meaning reacting and serving. The problem with that is that's an important element, but it's putting brakes on the relationship, not propelling the relationships forward. That's where you can exploit that opportunity. And my recommendation is one key question. If you really have to go right to the vendor relationships because you want to find out, ask them this simple question, not necessarily in the beginning, but sometime during the conversation. If you were to rank that existing vendor relationship from 1 to 10, 1 being lousy to 10 being truly outstanding, where might you rank that relationship? Or what number would you give that? Interesting enough, most people will say anywhere from a 7, 8, 8.5, or 9. Few, if any, would actually say a 10. And those few that do say a 10 is because they're trying to dismiss you, because they don't care or they're blowing you off. Be aware of that, okay? Sometimes that question can create open up a crevice for dialogue. But please, don't focus on existing vendor relationships. Focus on what your customers value. And that is the outcome, the success, and the opportunities they want to achieve. How can you help them get there? All right, we need to start transitioning this now as we start to bring closure to today's session. We are going to have, you will get access to this session today, a free recording. It'll be available for 10 days, and then it will be taken away. You'll also get in a follow-up email a free resource, and that is the top 8 questions that you can energize your customers in 2017. These are your prospective customers and your established relationships, whether it's to disrupt existing relationships now or dig deeper, broader, and higher. If you want to look at ways to say, hey, Paul, these are some good ideas, how can you customize? How can you tailor this? How can you actually work with our team to put together a strategy approach and some good tactics that we can use for takeaway, a roadmap? Let's talk. Give me a call. Let's explore something, whether it's a webinar, whether it's a live face-to-face engagement, that's something interactive and meaningful that we can put together for your group. Give us a call at 302-478-4443 or my email, cherry@pbresults.com. All right, we need to open it up for some questions, and one of the questions that we're being asked is, how do I deal with somebody who is putting a roadblock but won't allow me to talk to other relationships? That's a great question. Now, not having any more understanding besides that initial question, where you're trying to get through, this person says you don't need to talk to anybody but talk to me, but they're not giving you any input or insight. Look, I don't like stepping over people's heads, right? I don't like that, but if they're not giving you any business, and you're being blocked or being tackled, and they're not even returning your voicemails or responding to your emails, my question to you is, what do you have to lose? that's when you want to be looking for ways to say, to actually reach out to that individual and say, you know what, I've been attempting to reach to you a number of times, no feedback, no responses, which tell me your priorities have shifted. If I don't hear from you in the next few days, I'm going to reach out to other folks because I know this is meaningful and important to them. If it's still on your plate or your agenda or within your realm of responsibility, give me a call. Otherwise, no need to call me back. I'll talk to the other people. And that allows me very diplomatically, professionally, to reach out to other people. I need to be looking for these ways, okay? Not get tackled or roadblock if somebody's not receptive or open. Now, there's another question that came through, and that is, how would you approach a situation where, let's say, a current relationship or even a potential one tries to discredit your company's quality of deliverables in an effort to force you or corner you on discounted prices? Now, that's a really good question. And sometimes that's what happens, where we've lost an opportunity maybe a year or two, five, 10 years ago, and somebody is belittling or putting us down, remembering something that happened 10 years ago. Or it's an existing vendor. They don't want to give us more business because of a past experience. My recommendation is confront that situation. Is there emotion involved? And probably emotion versus logic. Let people verbalize, articulate, expand on them, get it out on the plate, on the table. Let's talk about it. What we do is we need to confront that and say is to tell them the resolution, what steps we took to resolve that matter, and what are the action plans moving forward, instilling the confidence and belief and the structure that we have the system in place to fix those issues. See, customers are very open and motivated, and they recognize that nothing is perfect. And what's even more important is when we can demonstrate how we can fix a problem and how we step and jump through the hoops and the barriers, that's where the passion and motivation is, that, you know what, you're looking out for me. So don't let people kind of trying to twist, what I call twist you on the price issue and poke you on the emotions. I want to push them back and talk about how we can create the value moving forward, not backwards. That's going to be important to make that happen. All right? Now, there is one other question, and that is, the question is, so for clarification, Paul, how do we overcome the price issue when we want to sell value? The question is, when somebody is going to push you on the price, come back and say, you know what, I recognize how important price is, and price should be an important element in making the important decisions for the success for you and your organization. Since you've asked the question about price, let me ask you, how do you define value? So tell me, what does value mean to you? And get some dialogue. Tell me what value means to your team. Tell me what value means to your company. Tell me what value means to your customers. There's your money. You want to minimize the price, getting cornered on price, because if you get cornered on price, you're going to lose. But if you get customers start talking about the service, quality, integrity, deliverables, there's other important criteria. There's probably history, motivation for you to expand on to minimize the price discussion, right? Because we've all seen the studies. Price is probably number three, number four in the areas what motivates people to decide. We like to think it's number one, but if it's true, if it is basic commodity, where it rarely, though, is it price. There are other elements involved, so we want to recognize that. All right? We are running out of time, and I certainly wish we had more time to cover this, but I respect the fact is when I say that we're going to give this to be a 30-minute session, it's my job to commit to that. If you have specific questions on your area of disrupting an existing vendor relationship, please email me. Reach out to me. I'll do my best to see what I can do to respond to your unique question or challenge. Reach out to us at cherry@pbresults.com. Thank you, everyone, for attending today's session and to your success in growing your business.